wireless sensor network routing protocol. This was an active research area until mid 2000s. So nowadays it's not popular anymore because the sensor network routing protocol assume stationary sensors, not moving sensors. And with stationary sensors, you can do easily all kinds of topology-based routing, especially hierarchical tree. Using the hierarchical tree, you can do the routing efficiently. And people first interested in how to distribute energy throughout the network field, because usually there are hotspots near the sink, because if you do the communication, the sink and their neighbors will participate more in the communication than this boundary node. Okay, so they suggest many ideas that can go around. Even though they take more delay, they can utilize energy more evenly across the network. Okay, so there are some variation of protocols, but not so much active right now. And people are moving to mobile sensor network or MANET or other areas, MAG or other issues. So let's review some of the early protocols proposed for the sensor network routing. So I'm giving you some early protocols. So flooding is the most simple approach. You just flood. If you want to send a packet, you know where is the destination. You send a packet, flood means we broadcast. Every node broadcast. And it will eventually arrive at the destination. Brute force approach. Okay? So, of course, nobody proposed this idea. You know, people they present, they give this as a baseline. If you do the flooding, there are many issues, then our protocol is at least better than this flooding, something like that. So each node broadcasts a packet, and usually they can set up this hop count of this packet. So they can set up this flooding range. I'm sending this packet, the maximum hop count is 5, then it will broadcast to 5 hops range, okay? And you don't have to maintain topology, and you don't have to do the route discovery. Route discovery means you have to find the route discovery, especially for the on-demand routing protocol used for MANET. Okay, so you don't have to do anything, you just flood, right? And there are many problems. And the first problem is called implosion. Implosion means, in this case, A broadcast packet A to B to C, and B broadcast A, and then D is receiving this packet A twice from B, one from C. And the same copy, the same message, but two copies are received by node D, and this is called implosion. Overlap means the same event can be detected by more than two sensors. Let's say these are the range. A can cover this range, and B can cover this range. But there are events, there are area, Q, R, and S, and R is detected by sensor A and sensor B. And if there is an event in R, if you send this event, then this R is redundant, right, from A and B. So same event can be detected by multiple sensors. That's some redundancy. It's called overlap. Resource blindness means if you do the broadcast or flooding, then you just broadcast, and especially everybody is broadcasting, then they might collide, and you have to do retransmission. Okay? And since everybody is participating, you are doing some overwork. Okay? So you waste your energy, and you waste your network bandwidth. It can decrease your energy, it can decrease your network lifetime, and it can decrease your network bandwidth utilized. Okay? That's the problem of flooding. So, if your protocol relies on flooding, that means it's somewhat inefficient, because flooding means it's doing some overwork. Okay? So, maybe one optimization you can do is, they call it gossiping. Gossiping is, instead of broadcast, you send it to a randomly selected neighbor. Okay, the idea is, okay, I'm a sensor. I want to send a packet to the destination. If I broadcast, everybody broadcast, too many packets are moving around and it's wasting your energy, wasting your network bandwidth. Okay, it may increase the delay also. So instead, I don't know, but I'm sending only this person. So it's like gossiping. Okay, I have a packet. Okay? So he has a packet he received from me, so he's not sending me, but he selects one of his neighbor. I have some good news. Okay? And eventually he did arrive at the destination. Okay? This is called gossiping. And this kind of routing is actually used in parallel computer also. And it's called chaos router, proposed by U.S. Washington and Seattle. So he ran, so in a supercomputer, there is also a router. Each processor has a router. They have a send message to send. The message goes through the router, and routers are connected through interconnection network. That's two-dimensional torus or mesh network. And they can use a bunch of routing, and one solution was chaos router. Chaos router is the same as this gossiping. It sends to anyone. And then it will eventually arrive. Because it sent to only one, and it's evenly distributed. So networks are utilized more evenly. And somehow, even though it will take more time, it will arrive. Because the packets are flying, these delays are not much importance. Because even though it's going around, the speed is speed of light, right? But if you have collision or congestion, then it will take too much time. So instead of selecting congestion, buffering, or collision, it's better to be around. Okay, that's the idea of this gossiping. Plus, so advantage, it avoids the problem of implosion. Implosion is the same copy twice. You don't receive the same copy twice. Lower overhead, less traffic, minus longer, maybe longer delay because you go around, and it does not guarantee the delivery. Sometimes destination might not hear, right? So that's the issue. So one interesting protocol you have to remember is this one, directed diffusion. Directed diffusion. This is one of the early sensor network routing protocol, but they use some different way of doing the routing compared to other address-based routing. So they call it data-centric routing. So it's worthwhile to pay attention. So in this data-centric routing, directed diffusion, maybe a node requests data by sending interest for this data. So instead of send this packet to destination node address 1000, in this case, the sync can broadcast this kind of interest. Detect vehicle location in coordinate 100 in x-axis and 100 in y-axis. And send me this event every 20 seconds. This is more like query, but this is a message. Okay? So, based on this query, you can do the routing. You can do the routing. So, this is called diffusion procedure. Diffusion procedure. It is doing in three steps. First, it propagates this interest. I'm interested in this data. So, usually, it's a sync broadcast this interest. I'm interested in this kind of data. So if you have sensors have this kind of data, report to me. Report to me. So sync broadcast interest to its neighbors. So it broadcasts its neighbors, and neighbors broadcast the same interest. It eventually broadcasts the entire sensor field. Okay? And gradients are set up pointing backward to where interest came from. Gradient means interests are coming from this sync and broadcast, and gradient is set up reverse way. Because when you send this message, you want to follow the reverse path of this interest coming from, right? So this gradient means the future path of this message will go through. Okay? That's the reverse path of this interest path. And in the middle, all these intermediate nodes cache this interest and data. So if data are still valid, they can immediately send this data. It doesn't have to go through the sensors. Okay? And also, if there are interests can be propagated from this intermediate node. And data propagation, this is the first step. And the second step is data propagation. That means once a source receives interest from the sink, oh, I have this data. Okay? He routes this sensor message along the gradient. So the interest came from this path, and all the intermediate nodes set up this gradient, which is the future path. This message will go through. So he sends a message. I have this data, and this message goes through this this gradient. Okay, that's the data propagation. So data propagates through the sink. Okay, reinforcement. After sink starts receiving events, so after a while the data will come back from the source sensors, and sensor enforce some particular path to receive high quality data. Maybe the sink might collect some data, and the same data, there might be multiple data coming from the different sensors or the same sensors, but different paths. And maybe some paths has shorter delay than the other. So the sink reinforces this path. I want to receive from this path because it gives you this message earlier and suppress the other. So for this gradient, he can increase his weight or decrease his weight. So he has a better chance of sending this packet through this path. That's the reinforcement procedure. Okay? So gradients from source to sink are initially small, but increase during this reinforcement. Okay? So this is an example. The sink broadcasts interest, and it will eventually arrive at the source. In the meantime, the gradients are set up in the reverse direction. Okay? So all this reverse direction, gradient are set up. This will be the future path. And this should be the long. This should be the other way around. Right? Because this is the interest going from here to here, the gradient should set up reverse way. So this is a long. Okay. And then using the gradient, so send packets, so source can send this packet in this path, or in this path, or in this path. And the sink this path is the fastest. So he reinforced this path, and in the future, because it had higher gradient value, it will use this path to send message to the destination. Okay? That's called directed diffusion, and they can support multiple source and multiple sink within this message. And this is called directed diffusion. It's a different way of doing message communication. Let's look at another issue. Another issue that was interesting is mobile sync. Mobile sync means, so far, they assume all the sensors are stationary, and even the sync are stationary. But sync can be mobile. Assume that you have some mountings, and you have fire alarm sensor network. And humans can be a sync. They come up with some smartphones and collect some information about some fire alarm system or agricultural sensors. And these humans can be mobile. And this sync, if the sync is mobile, it's not easy because usually the sync are the root of this topology-based routing. If the sync is moving, the sync must announce their location. And then whenever sync move, this topology should change based on the sync location. And then there are many issues. Location of mobile sync need to be continuously propagated throughout the sensor field. And frequent, if the sync is moving too much, frequent location updates from multiple mobile sync lead to excessive energy drain of sensor node, increased collision. So he has to broadcast his location every time. It has to be flooded throughout the sensor field. And this will increase the energy, increase the collision, reduce your efficiency. And TTDD, they propose this kind of, here, let me explain first. Sensors are stationary, but sinks are mobile, and sensors are equipped with GPS. So they know the location. Each data source builds some grid structure, a two-dimensional grid. Each source forwards this data to a set of sensor nodes called the disseminating nodes, a grid point. So here, let's say that each source maintains some kind of two-dimensional grid or mesh network. So he announced this data, and using the GPS, he generates this kind of grid network in the covering the sensor field. These are the sensor network. These black nodes are disseminating nodes. his magnetic north. That's some center that can receive message from the sink. So if sink can move, they can send a query. They don't have to flood their query to everybody else. They can flood only in this field, only in this area, local cell. And then the closest disseminating node becomes immediate dissemination node. And then this, he relays this query to the source using this disseminating node. And then source sends this data along this gradient and it arrives at the sink. Okay? And if the sink is moving, if he's within his range, he can still send the data. But if he's moving the other way, then he can buffer the message. And he, whenever he broadcasts, another immediate disseminating node is responsible for receiving this query. And then he can relay this message to the another disseminating node. And then he can send this data. Okay? So this is the scheme. The problem is they assume GPS-enabled sensors. So everybody should have GPS. GPS is quite expensive, so it costs maybe $5 or something like that. So it's not can be used for large scale sensors. And also, every sensor maintains this grid, which is very inefficient scheme. Because this is one sensor, each sensor should maintain this kind of grid. Okay, so this is quite inefficient. And so we come up with some new idea. This is called virtual sink rotation. This is my idea. We address this mobile sink and the hotspot problem using this virtual sink rotation. So far, several schemes have been proposed to target this mobile sink issue. We have looked at this TTDD, which was proposed by UCLA people and presented to MOBICOM 2002. There are another protocol called SEED, Scalable Energy Efficient Asynchronous Dissemination from Seoul National University. It was presented to CENSIS 2003. And another scheme, HLETDR from USC. However, all these schemes have suffered from some limitation. TTDD are using local flooding, so it uses flooding, at least in each cell. And flooding means it's inefficient. And HLETDR or DD use global flooding. So global flooding means it should not be efficient, okay? And the SEED and HLETDR, TTDD rely on GPS. GPS receivers are too expensive and may not work indoors. And they might use localization technique, but this is not accurate enough. So either they rely on GPS or they use this kind of flooding. So far, when I look at this problem, no practical routing solution. So I came up with some new idea called virtual sink rotation routing. So here in this example, the soldiers becoming a sink, the sensors are scattered around the battlefield. And they can detect the movement of opponent tank, or they can detect the chemical weapons that are odorless. And humans may not detect this chemical weapon, but sensors can do, okay? And then they can relay this message to the sink. So VSR idea is simple. So the problem for before, mobile sink, they trying to track the mobile sink, and the sink is keep moving. And he constantly send messages and propagate, and there are too many messages, and topology are changing all the way. Right, all the time. That's waste of time and waste of energy. Instead of doing that, let's not follow this mobile sink. Let's assign a normal sensor as a sink, and let's call it virtual sink. It's stationary sensors. They are not mobile. So if you have an event, you just report to this virtual sink. You don't care about this real sink. It's moving around. Let's worry about that later. Let's report all these events to virtual sync, okay? So using the virtual sync, you can build a spanning tree, we call it VS tree, instead of this actual sync. So starting from the virtual sync, we can construct a tree, So tree means whenever you do the routing, you can send your packet to your parent, and then parent, and then eventually arrive at the root. So it's very simple, right? So this tree is constructed at the initial deployment stage. When the sensors are deployed, you assign a virtual sink, and you can construct a tree. And whenever there's some node failure, I have also this failure recovery algorithm. We can repair the tree, and we can maintain this tree, And this tree, a sink, acts as a data collection center and data dissemination center. It collects all the messages or events from sensors. And during the sensors, if they have some redundant data, they can aggregate. Okay? And it can also act as a dissemination center, so you can broadcast this messages to any other sensors, including the mobile sync. Okay? So the idea is like this. You assign some sensor as a virtual sync. You construct this virtual sync tree. And if you have a source, source sends this message through their parent and it will arrive at the virtual sync. You don't have to keep track of this sync. Let's worry about sync later. So whenever you have a message, you can send a packet to the sync. Sync have all the message. Okay? How about the real sync? They can be mobile. Real sync, when they are not moving, within their range, there might be some sensors, existing sensors. He can send this message to this agent. I just say forwarding agent. Okay? So he can set up this path. This is called virtual path. Sync from the virtual sync. If he has a message or query using this virtual path, he can send a packet to the virtual sync. And virtual sync can send a message to the sync. So he collects all the message, and whenever sync location is identified, he sends this message to the sync. Okay? Easily. You don't have to have all this path information. They also only need to maintain neighbor information. To send to this sync, I only have sent to this neighbor, then it will eventually go to the sync. This is called virtual sync. Whenever sync is moving, it's doing virtual path removal. He removes this message, and I notify this agent that I'm moving. Okay? And then it will forward this message further. It will keep this message until it settles down. Sync is moving, it settles down here, and another virtual path set up. And then he can forward this message to this sync. Okay? So with this mechanism, you can support multiple sync and sync movement easily. So as long as it's in the sensor field, he has neighbors. Neighbors are already in the VS tree. Okay? I send this message to the agent. I'm here. And then he already knows how to send the packet to the sync. So he set up this virtual path, and then virtual sync can send all this message to this sync. Sync can collect this message. Whenever I move, I remove and set up another path. Okay? And I can easily support all mobile sync and multiple mobile sync. Okay? And here, a node has this relationship. Parent means VS tree. Node send a message to this parent. And there are upper level other nodes, or sibling, or peer, or children. So in my algorithm, some of them I use up, peer, or children, or down to repair or to reorganize this VS tree. Because it should be fault tolerant. And if I use virtual sync too long, then sync and neighbor node will consume too much energy. So I'm doing the rotation. Instead of this sync, I'm assigning any other sync, any other sensor as another virtual sync, and remove this role. And using this rotation, I can evenly distribute this energy across the sensor field. That's the another idea. So I can remove this hotspot, solve the hotspot problem also. Okay? So that's the another idea. Virtual sync rotation. Rotate the role of virtual sync among all the candidate sensors, because virtual sync and its neighbor to consume more energy than lymph node. So by doing this, we can distribute the energy evenly across the sensor field. Okay? So we do the simulation. Network size of 400 nodes, 2 kilometer by 2 kilometer, assuming 802.11 main layer, 100 second simulation time, we change number of source, number of sync, sync mobility, and we look at these metrics. So this is assuming stationary sensors. VSR can be used for stationary sensors and also stationary sync and also mobile sync. Okay, stationary sync, let's compare to TTDD and directed diffusion. Right? So I change this number of sync. We increase number of sync from 1 sync to 16 sync. Directed diffusion, as you increase the number of sync, this delay becomes substantial. Right? TTDD delay is lower, but compared to VSR, it's much higher. Right? About more than maybe 300% higher delay. VSR is not much difference. Slightly increase as you increase the number of sync. Okay? How about the delivery rate? In you send the message, what's the success rate of arriving at the destination? I compare only TTDD and VSR because DD is much lower. This is TTDD. TTDD is, you use the code from the TTDD people, UCLA people, but their code is not stable. So it's actually, as you increase the number of sync, it's delivery success rate is increasing. And if you look at some other their data are somewhat fluctuation. Their code is not stable. Anyhow, they have shown about 80% delivery rate. We are almost 98%. As you increase to 16, then we have some drop. But until async, we have 98% delivery ratio. And energy consumption, we consume less than half of the energy compared to directed diffusion and TTDD. Okay. The second data is we change the number of source instead of number of sync, assuming only one stationary sync. And directed diffusion, as you increase the number of source, it increases substantially because you do flooding for each sync, right? Each source also. And direct TTDD, you have fluctuation. VSR, almost the same. Delivery ratio, VSR 99%, TTDD 50%, energy much lower compared to DD and TTDD. And this is stationary sync, stationary sensors. This is mobile sync, more interesting case that we are targeting this issue. Mobile sync, we just compared to the TTDD because directed diffusion is not solution for mobile sync. So we compare only TTDD and VSR. We change the sync speed from 0 to 20 millimeter per second. 20 meter per second is very fast. So it's more like a fast moving car. And even though moving car, our delay is almost about the same. Right? You can support easily without increasing delay, but TTDD is increasing, right? Zigzag. How about the delivery success ratio? We give about more than 90% with high speed movement, but TTDG, 8%, but suddenly drops when the speed increases to 20 meters per second. And energy consumption is, as I said, much lower compared to TTDD because we don't have this maintenance overhead of every source maintaining this grid, right? We have just a tree, that's all. And we can support mobile sync and multi-sync easily. Okay, that's the idea of VSR. Node failures. I manually assume this is failed. This is failed. Increase this failure rate from 0 to 20%. And we have failure recovery algorithm. We have to, whenever node failed, we have to do partial recovery, reset up your parent, reset up your child. And then the message should be delivered to the sync. And as you increase the failure rate, it should still give reasonable delivery success ratio with node failure rate. This is assuming the same size sensor field, we increase the number of node density. As you increase the node density, DD and TTDD are not scalable. They increase their energy consumption. But VSR constant. That means it's more scalable. Even though you increase number of sensors, you don't have to have any global knowledge or maintenance overhead. You just need neighbor information, that's all. It's entirely distributed protocol. Okay? And this is you increase the number of sensor nodes and you also increase the sensor field size accordingly, and this is the energy. Energy consumption is still about the same, which means it's scalable in terms of network size, in terms of density. This is rotation policy. If you don't do the rotation, if you use one virtual sink, then sooner or later, black means you deplete all of your energy. So sink and neighbor nodes deplete all of their energy. So we have network hold. This means eventually network lifetime, it ends because you cannot send the packet to the virtual sink. But you can do the rotation. This is you select a node with maximum energy as a virtual sink. You select virtual sink randomly. This is random selection. This is maximum energy selection. Actually, random selection gives better solution. So use this rotation. This is same amount of simulation time. We don't have black holes, right? We can reduce this red area much lower using this rotation policy, right? But we cannot avoid this kind of red area at the center because eventually, whenever, even if you select this node as a virtual sink, the message will go through here and there will be more message going through the center rather than this boundary. So eventually, this will become a hole. But using the rotation, you can alleviate the problem. Okay, that's the idea of virtual sync rotation. So virtual sync can avoid local or global. This is not forwarding, flooding. We don't use flooding, okay? So we do not use GPS sensors. We do not use flooding. We also address this energy hotspot problem using the rotation, okay? So this is, you can implement this virtual sync rotation for large-scale sensor network because it is scalable, entirely distributed, and you can utilize this for low-cost sensors because you don't need GPS, okay? And I still believe this is the best sensor network routing protocol for the stationary sensors, okay? That's the VSR. Okay, this is the end of this topic. Since we have 10 minutes left, let me give you some introduction about the MANET. So let's move our topic from sensor network to mobile ad-hoc networks, which means node is not a sensor, node is more powerful, and node can be mobile. Node can be mobile, and there is no sink, there is no source. Everybody is the same. It's called peer. It's peer-to-peer communication, okay? And it's still ad-hoc networks. So there is no infrastructure. There is no base station, there is no access point. It's self-organizing networks. So maybe if you have conference, everybody with smartphone, with Bluetooth network, this becomes mobile ad-hoc networks, right? Bluetooth network, but each node can be mobile. Smartphone people are mobile networks, okay? Also the car, vehicle networks are mobile networks. They can communicate through their, usually nowadays they all have this 3G, or Wi-Fi network, they can communicate with their neighbor node, okay? There is no AP or there is no base station. It's also self-organizing because there is no router. Whenever these nodes are gathering, you have to self-organize your network by yourself, okay? And it's mobile node. Any node can be mobile anytime. And here it's not a sensor, local sensor, it's human, smartphone, or vehicle, or robot. So each node is assumed to be more powerful in terms of power, energy, and memory, and computation. Okay? And you might replace your battery also, right? So examples are automobile networks, mobile user networks. And communication pattern is any node can send a packet to any other node. So it's peer-to-peer communication or many-to-many communication pattern. There is no source, there is neither sink. The networking issues are much difficult because everybody can be mobile. So you don't know the location of your destination. So you cannot easily utilize topology-based routing since the mobility of node may change and topology can change any time. So node mobility may lead to frequent routing failures. Okay, so how we can do the routing in this complex network? That's the issue. Routing protocols proposed for MANET can be classified into Mainly two groups. One is proactive routing, the other is reactive routing. Proactive routing is table driven. Reactive routing is not table driven. This is somewhat traditional way of doing the routing. You have routing table based on the routing table, you send it back. So this is more topology based routing. You can still use topology based routing for this MANET. MANET. And the examples are DSDB and OSLR and TBRPF. And these are all standard, these two are standardized by IETF, Internet Engineering Task Force. And this is somewhat interesting idea. We'll study this DSDB. And the most famous scheme is called AODB. This is not proactive protocol, this is reactive protocol. Reactive protocol means, proactive protocol means you build a topology always. You know a path, you know routing table. So like tree or some kind of routing table, if I want to send a packet to that destination, I should send a packet to this neighbor, and it will eventually arrive at the destination. So somehow, if you combine all these routing tables, they maintain this entire topology. Okay? And somehow, basically, what they want to do is they want to have this shortest path algorithm. If you want to arrive at the destination, they, using this maintain this table and topology, they go through this shortest path, because that's the fastest path from source to destination. Okay? And reactive protocols are different. Reactive protocols are, because nodes are moving around so fast and anytime, maintaining this table has too much overhead. You have to change whenever some nodes are moving, right? So these maintenance messages are moving around and flooding, and there are too much overhead. Let's not worry about this. Let's don't do anything. Let's leave them alone. Move around anytime. And then whenever you have a packet to send, you send a packet. You find out route by sending a route discovery message. How? You flood this packet, route discovery packet. That's called RREQ, route request. By flood, and it will eventually arrive at the destination. Right? And then when it goes through, it collects, it, like gradient, it set up a path in the reverse path. Using the reverse path, there is a loud reply message coming from the destination. And then I can send the packet through this path. That's the reactive protocol. This DSR, to record this reverse path, they use this packet header, loud request packet header, they record this path at the header message. And when they reply, and the receiver, destination receive, they look at this path information at the RREQ packet, they go back using this path information. Okay, that's the DSR. AODB combined the idea of DSR and DSDB. And this is much more optimized than DSR and DSDB. And it's standardized by IETF as RFC 350-561. Hybrid protocol, they combine these protocols. And locally, they use maybe floating, globally they use something like that, right? Those are hybrid protocols. So this is from IETF Engineering, Internet Engineering Task Force Working Group for MANET. They classify MANET protocol into table-driven, which is proactive approach, on-demand, there is reactive approach, and hybrid approach, and there are some other cluster-based approach. And these are the major protocols. And we'll study these, and we'll focus on this AODB, because this is the most popular MANET routing protocol. This is based on DSDB and DSR, so we'll study, start from DSDB and DSR, and we'll briefly look at this OSLR and TBRPF. And this table-driven approach, this is a traditional way of doing the routing, can be divided into distance vector routing and link state routing. This is global view. They don't have global view, but it's more scalar, it's more distributed. So they use, usually all this protocol use this distance vector routing. Okay, so Maybe next week we start from here. Okay? Okay, this is the end of class today. And